they gave him a scholarship.
Payne was constantly around our fraternity house, and that was my first introduction to Payne.
Payne was a lot of free-spirited. His golf wasn't his first priority.
We had a really good team at that point in time, so he had a real hard time making even the starting lineup or his first year.
Payne's game was very solid in the ball striking area.
And he had an air of confidence about him. It was a little bit of cockiness.
His short game was not anywhere near what it was in the later years. But he hit the ball extremely long back then.
We all knew there was something very special about that swing from the first time we saw it.
They say college is the best years of your life, and I think we tried to make that happen. We had a great time down at school. I'd like to say that studies came first, but they didn't always come first.
It could be said that Payne majored in theory of party. It was party management, according to some, but I don't think you'd put the management there. Payne was just full 100% party.
Yeah, he always he partied quite a lot. We all did.
SMU has a lot of very attractive co-eds there.
We all had a few beverages from time to time. You know, this is where I don't know how much we get into, but...
Well, I love a good party.
he was really always the life of the party and the center of the party, and everyone wanted to be around him.
Well, his major was real estate. He had a business degree, and his major was real estate. And as I would tell him, and I would tell Tracy, and we've kidded about it for years, it is a blessing Payne could play golf, because if he had to rely on his career in real estate, I don't think he would have been able to feed his family.
Academically wasn't his big focus, but a college degree was very important to him.
Payne is one of the very few PGA players that ever graduated with his class in 4 years. It was not an easy task. He struggled like all of us in school, but he survived.
Up until his senior year, he had not lived up to all the hype and all the everything that was expected of Payne. You know, I don't think he had won any tournaments. And I remember Bill coming down and really having a heart-to-heart with Payne.
He said, well, what are you going to do when you get out of college? You're going to graduate in May. What are you going to do? I said, well, I'm going to play golf for a living. He said, well, what makes you think you can play golf professionally? He says, you haven't done anything in college but have fun. You know, so it ends up, you know, that little bit of prod. I go my last semester in college. I win 3 golf tournaments. Fred Couples and I tied for the Southwest Conference Championship.
He was so cocky at the start because he, right after he was out of college, he played in a professional tournament in Carthage, Missouri, and he won it. Well, he thought, well, there's nothing, this is a piece of cake.
I think Payne went into it at that point in the summer of 79 thinking that the game would be a breeze for him, that the success would continue that he had experienced that spring. Well, as we all know, he faced several obstacles and didn't get his tour card until several years later.
It was 79. I just got missed the qualifying school, so I'm out at the club, and I told this guy that I'm working at JCPenney. He says, oh, you should come down and work at my clothing store. You'll make more money working for me. Well, I'm a stock boy. You know, I thought I was going to be selling, you know. I'm a college graduate. I can sell.
Like Dad.
Yeah, I'm, you know, painting the bathroom, folding clothes. I can fold clothes, though. I'm good for clothes folding. And so I get my check for 2 weeks' work, $83. Now, I'd just been out on the golf course the day before. I beat some pigeons out of about 150. I went in and quit that day.
The big key to that, I believe, was going to Asia, meeting Tracy, and also seeing how players in other parts of the world got the ball up and down, got it in the hole.
We were amongst the group where our resumes were accepted by the Asian Golf Federation to go over there and play. So East meets West in that regard, in that we would think somebody would turn left, they turn right. In India, we found girls that would follow behind the cows and make cow patties out of their manure and put them up on the wall. And then they would, after they dried, those were sold as fuel to cook on. So to us, you know, that was like, you gotta be kidding me. You know, what is the aroma on that food? You know, we're not eating anything local.
We were just hoping he'd get home alive.
And, we were hoping he'd do well, which he did do well. But once again, that was pure talent.
Payne and I guess the best phrase would be gloves are off, okay? Anything goes. It doesn't matter. We're 15, 20,000 miles away from home. We both had fun.
Well, I was in between jobs at the time, and my brother suggested that I go with him for a three-week vacation.
Payne and I saw Tracy at a cocktail party at Royal Selangor Golf Club in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. And we saw her from across the room. And he saw her first and said, wow, look at that.
And I just saw Payne across the room, you know, soon after we arrived there. And he was just the most beautiful thing I'd ever seen.
They went out the first night, and Payne decided he was going to impress Tracy. And this is 1980. He's going to impress Tracy by using one of his credit cards to pay for dinner.
He kept giving the guy credit cards, and he kept coming back and saying, no, we don't take that, sir, sorry. And he just kept giving him another one and another one, and I thought, oh, you jerk, you're just trying to impress me with all your credit cards.
He came in that night, and he came into the room, and his quote to me was, he looked me dead in the eye, and he said, that's the girl I'm going to marry.
I think I knew the first night that this was the man that I wanted to marry, and apparently he thought the same thing.
I think she was the true missing piece to completion of his puzzle.
They made a great team. Tracy kept him going down that right path, and I think she was a steadying force for him, and I think she was an important part of him becoming a great player.
Without Tracy, Payne would have become a good player. He would have never become the superstar that he became without her. And I think if he was sitting here next to me today, he would agree with that.
There's a company that can help you find your way in today's financial world. One that knows both sides of wealth, growing it and protecting it. With a full spectrum of financial solutions, advice from skilled professionals, and smart strategies to keep you on course. Company that's been managing wealth for 125 years. We're Prudential Financial, growing and protecting your wealth.
All around the world, Siemens is energizing cities and towns we live in. We engineer new ways to efficiently generate, distribute, and use power. And by providing energy to people everywhere, we're giving them the power to live better.
Spin, spin, spin the globe. It's your turn, spin the globe.
I'm singing in the rain, just singing in the rain. I'm happy again.
Want over 200 channels with crystal clear reception even when it rains? You can't get that from satellite.
I'm singing and dancing in
Time Warner Cable. Now, anything's possible.
Welcome to Northwest Houston's most spectacular new golf community, Augusta Pines. Select one of 10 models designed by Houston's finest custom builders, or choose your home site and bring your own builder. Large wooded home sites are still available on Sports Illustrated's number 4 rated golf course, located in the award-winning Klein School District. Augusta Pines, an elegant southern lifestyle.
Early on, Payne was a little bit cocky.
He was brash and he was cocky and he was going to make it.
He started making decent checks. He knew he had made enough to keep his card for the next year. And then he came to the Magnolia Classic where, even though they say it's unofficial, it was his first tour win against tour quality players.
I'll never forget his comments after he won. He said, well, I think the tour needs more blonde-haired, blue-eyed guys. And I was like, golly, this guy's unbelievable.
Payne was always a little brash. But when he started wearing knickers, boy, he raised some eyebrows.
In 82, I was playing, and I was wearing Izod clothes at the time. And I had on red slacks, white shirt,
red stripe in it, you know, looking like your typical golfer. And two guys down from me on the practice tee had the exact same clothes on. And right then I decided I didn't want to look like he did. So that's where the knickers came along. First term I debuted them in, I'm playing in Atlanta on a Saturday. I'm playing with Trevino, a pair of lavender knickers out. You know, I was looking good in them too. And, you know, Trevino busted me a little hard on the first tee, but I expected that. And so, but the comments I got that day were very favorable, and that's probably the reason I've continued to do it.
It was a great look, and I think Payne was probably the only one that could have pulled it off.
They really are very splendid shoes, aren't they?
When he came out with that stuff, I said, boy, I sure hope you have enough game to back that stuff up.
I used to always kid him about how he felt about going in the Circle K on the way home or the 7-Eleven, and what did the people think of him when he went in there to buy that Coke or whatever, you know?
You know, then when he signed the NFL deal, you know, then it became a game. Because we'd get into a city, you know, and all of a sudden now we're wearing, you know, we're in Dallas and we're wearing the NFC East, the Redskins, the Giants, the Eagles, the rivals in the division. So, you know, he liked to stir it up.
He loved the people that kind of, oh, you know, if you're in Chicago, we'd have a Packer thing on or something, and they'd give him the needle, but he'd come back with the Bears on Sunday, and, you know, that's just the kind of guy he was. I don't know if it was subconscious that it would turn into a identity or an icon. I didn't realize that then, but it was probably one of the better marketing decisions I ever made in my life.
Ironically, the first time Payne wore his knickers all four rounds was in the 1982 Quad Cities tournament.
My most prestigious victory to myself was the Quad Cities in 82, because my father was there and got to see it.
In fact, Jim Thorpe walks up to me, I remember, I'll never forget, on one hole, he goes, who is this guy, Payne? Because Payne was just playing awesome.
What a thrill it was. I think his father and I both just cried and cried.
You know, we had a big cry up on the 18th green when it finished, and, you know, that's the thing that we've always had in our family. I've always been a pretty emotional person.
The Quad Cities event was even more important to Payne Stewart because in 1984, he realized that his father was diagnosed with cancer.
We were visiting there in Springfield, and this was, I think, about 2 weeks before he passed away. And we had just found out that I was pregnant with Chelsea.
And he'd told his father that he was going to that he was going to be a father. That's how he told him.
He went up to him and he whispered in his ear, I'm going to be a daddy.
Bill said, don't have more than two. And Payne says, well, what about me? I was the third one.
And his dad just got this big old smile on his face and looked at Payne and said, don't buy expensive baby furniture. It only wears out.
That's always one of my most special conversations I ever had with my father, telling him that Tracy and I were expecting Chelsea, and that was special. It was, you know, I look back on that, and I, you know, I miss him a lot. I wish he was, I know he's still watching, but I wish I could hug him when I win or whatever and talk to him personally. It would be special.
I know that his father's death really, really hurt him.
He just felt like it. You know, there is no justice in the world. Why would his father, a man that, you know, very athletic man, never drank, never smoked, you know, lived a good life, why should he have cancer? He didn't show any emotion at the funeral, didn't cry, and it was a strange reaction from Payne, because he's usually a very emotional person and, you know, never afraid to cry.
And I know he brought his daughter back here one time and went out to the cemetery and did his crying out there with her. He finally could have tears about it after he took her out to the cemetery to pay homage to his father.
I think at that point he became a man in his mind, that you know, he was grown up now, and he had children, and he needed to do what Bill would have done. Bill was a great man.
Dad had given me a piece of paper that he had written out for Payne so that while we were out on tour, I could watch for certain things that he was doing.
It was kind of emotional, but for our anniversary one year, my wife had it framed and gave it to me, and now sits in my golf room where I work on my clubs.
What a neat thing to be able to see, as much as you obviously still miss your dad.
I wish he'd, wish he could have seen some of the things that I've done.
He'd have been awfully proud, wouldn't he?
I think so.
Pray for a little peace till we meet again someday.
Where do the pros shop for golf gifts during the holidays?
Well, from the North Pole to South Florida, golfers know that for great prices on name-brand golf equipment, log on to the Golf Warehouse at www.tgw.com. Do your holiday shopping at the Golf Warehouse and receive free second-day air on all orders over $100. So avoid the rush and log on to the Golf Warehouse, the net's premier online golf superstore.
tgw.com makes my job so easy. Ho, ho, ho.
What are these?
Magic business binoculars.
How do they work?
You look through them, you see the future of business.
Wow. The future sure looks different.
What do you see?
It's a 3D holographic projection of the world to come.
Things move fast. Everything's integrated. Everything works in real time.
How do we get everything to work?
I don't know. It says I need another quarter.
Every season, history is made, records are set, and new stars are born. They are the year's greatest golf moments. Join the Golf Channel for a week of special programming dedicated to the year in golf. From Monica to Zeller, we'll show 365 days worth of the best and most memorable moments from this season, including the announcement of Peter Jacobson's All Jake team. Greatest Golf Moments Week on the Golf Channel, presented by Hyundai. Relive the memories December 16th through the 22nd.
We moved to Orlando in 1984 because Orlando had such a great airport and, you know, it was great weather so he could practice all year round. Scott and Sally Hope lived here and we had become friends with them and they invited us to stay with them after Disney.
You know, we said, hey, you know, be at home and all, and he was. In fact, one morning, I think Sally was up and he comes walking into the kitchen to get some orange juice or something and he had it on his briefs. And Sally, you just say, you know, Payne, we're pretty good friends, but I think you need to wear a little more around the house, maybe not make yourself so at home.
Payne Stewart came to Bay Hill a number of years ago. I thought he had just a world of talent. He had a swing that I certainly envied because it was everything that my swing wasn't. It was long, smooth, and very powerful.
Always seemed to be a guy who, when he got to a difficult golf course, always played it pretty well, but never really won.
He was winning a lot of money, but he wasn't actually winning tournaments. He was coming second a lot.
Left it short. Back-to-back double bogeys, and the mania has gone out of the Mustang.
And he got the nickname Avis for second, you know, finishing second. Maybe it should have been for We Try Harder.
It bothered him for a while because he had a lot of good tournaments, but, you know, sometimes he just couldn't finish it off, and sometimes he just played well, and the other guy just played better.
There goes Payne Stewart. Do you think that's not a lonely walk?
Yes, defeat is always a lonely walk.
There were several losses that I believe really frustrated Payne a great deal. One of them was the 1984 Colonial in Fort Worth, when he blew a two-shot lead and lost to Peter Jacobson.
The week before the Colonial, my father went in for surgery on his throat because of cancer. He had a one-stroke lead with one to play. He bogeyed the last hole. I birdied the first hole. Turn around. He goes from winning to losing. And Payne came up to me and he gave me a hug and he said, this one was for your dad. He said, tell your dad to hang in there, and I'm thinking of him. And it just, it made, in fact, I kind of tear up when I think about it right now. And he was so kind to me to say that, that I told my father, and my father never forgot that. And I feel that I will be entwined with Payne Stewart's life forever.
I believe the frustration finally came out of him in 1987 when he won the Bay Hill in Orlando, shooting a then record score.
And just the fact that he lived right off the 12th tee, you know, seeing Chelsea as he came by, giving her a hug and a kiss. Not many golf tournaments you can play in where you have that opportunity to kiss your daughter.
When he won Bay Hill, we were all very pleased, and have one of our own guys win the tournament was very special.
After winning Bay Hill, I thought that it was going to be a perfect time to honor my father in his memory, how much he loved, you know, my love for him, and what I thought of him by donating all my tournament winnings to the Florida Hospital in Orlando for cancer research patients' families.
When you get to see what it's really gone for and how it's going to be able to help the community and families that had to go through what I went through, and it's really going to be something special.
The thing he liked the most was the Golf Digest cover where it showed the monkey getting off his back.
I think that all of a sudden, Payne took that step where you're near the winner's circle a lot, and then you have some wins, and then all of a sudden it's like you take that next step to where your focus becomes majors.
The Professional Golfers Association of America presents the 71st PGA Championship from Kemper Lakes Golf Course in Hawthorne Woods, Illinois.
We're seven shots behind with nine to play. I mean, you're not really thinking about winning. You're just thinking about another high finish. But he goes out and shoots 31.
I remember kind of being surprised when I looked at the leaderboard on the last couple of holes because first thought was, where did he come from?
And look at this. That was a beautiful roll. It was right in the middle of the hole.
And he has it right all the way and runs it about 3 feet by.
Payne birdies 14, 15, 16, and 18 to shoot 31 on the back nine.
The only regret Payne would have from his first victory is the way he handled himself after he had completed play and Mike Reed was still out on the course.
He was just kind of eating grapes and messing around for the camera. He really wasn't, you know, making fun of what Mike Reed was doing at all. He was just a little immature and didn't realize what it would look like.
We all do things that we look back on and think, geez, how could I do that, especially things on TV.
There's the 1989 PGA champion, Payne Stewart. It's a heartbreaking moment for Mike Reed.
What people said about it and how he acted, that really is long under the bridge, and the lowest score wins, and he got the job done.
And this is what the game of golf is all about.
Bob, what a wonderful player Payne Stewart is.
He sure is, and he deserves to win a major championship. He'll be a fine champion.
New phone.
Well, of course it's Motorola. I own Motorola.
I got a
Mega VIP, owner of Motorola.
What?
Okay, we have a code 3 VIP. Food, penthouse, lobby, go.
Yeah.
You need anything, just let me know.
Make sure the room's ready.
What? I got the room! I don't know what they are.
What do you want?
They took the cake out of the wedding.
Eagle has landed.
How are you?
I'm pretty good.
Good. You know I've admired your work.
Which is what?
Wowie zowie.
Mr. Chairman, I presume?
I'm Mike. I just got off the shuttle.
Ownership. It's for everybody. At Ameritrade, everything you need to trade, all for $10.99. Every online equity trade, no matter how many shares you buy. 80 million Americans have a share. Ameritrade. What's your share? Open an account at Ameritrade.com and get 25 commission-free internet equity trades.
Messaging easy so you can see your world in a whole new way. Nokia, connecting people.
He was a difficult guy to play with. He was always fidgeting around. He was always in his bag. He was always making noises, oblivious to it all.
Payne was not only ADD, but also was very hyper, and he had a lot of impulsive behaviors which frequently accompany the condition.
Numerous times I had to just grab him and wait. Until he hits the shot. And he would, because he wasn't paying attention.
He would many times put his foot in his mouth to the press because of his impulsiveness. He would know it just about as soon as he did it, but use it too late.
Payne would always blurt out exactly what he felt.
Payne could make things dicier.
Was he a little abrasive at times? Sure.
All of us American golfers on the Ryder Cup team, we are Chinese too. Thank you very much.
Oh, well, congratulations, Payne. You just insulted 2 billion people.
I know he never meant for anything to go the wrong way like that. It just, he was good at, like I say, putting his foot in his mouth.
Sometimes you don't always conduct yourself the way you should. And I've bitten the heads off some of the media people at when they come up to me at the wrong time and ask that dumbass question when in that situation where you just lost, well, how does it feel? Well, you want to go, what do you think?
Payne was a not only a good golfer, but a character, and my way of thinking, he was a piece of work.
He did it, Forrest Gump, just like Forrest Gump, you know, because I don't know what to say about that.
Some people are peas and some people are carrots, and obviously this guy's big pea, and I'm big carrot.
No matter where he was, no matter whose company he was in, he enjoyed himself.
He loved to party.
And there was always some kind of music going.
Playing Jimmy Buffett music.
What was his favorite Jimmy Buffett song?
Margaritaville.
Wasting away again in Margaritaville.
He loved to make margaritas.
He made the best margaritas.
Searching for my sugar salt.
Payne loved to barbecue.
Was a good cook. I think he thought he might have been a better cook than he actually was.
Always something had to be happening with Payne.
Baseball, softball, basketball.
Why run all the jet skis, the boats?
That's what he loved most in life, I think, you know, was coming home and being with his family.
Mischievous, sometimes, you know, it's practical joker.
At Muirfield, you know, all Payne has to do is kind of make a par on this hole, and he's got this thing won.
Zinger's in that bunker going. All of a sudden, he goes like this, and I'm okay, you got to make this putt. And this ball's rolling, and it's rolling, and it's rolling. I don't need to see this again. Miss! Oh, it went in again. I can't believe it. Now all of a sudden I'm going, you got to make this putt to tie. And I didn't make it. And then I missed the next one, which was irrelevant because, you know, who remembers?
Who finished third?
Yeah.
Right.
It was me.
So I walked up and said, hey, I'm sorry. He said, hey, don't worry about it. Great shot. You deserve it. Congratulations. Way to go. I go to the 18th green, do my ceremony. He goes down to the press room, says what he needs to say, holding his head high. He goes up in the locker room, stuffs my shoes full of bananas.
He and Zinger were relentless on each other.
There was a stretch where that's all those two guys did.
It was 3 or 4 years ago, and we were at Augusta National. He's kind of over there, and he's got his head kind of down a little bit like this, and he's kind of got his hand kind of here. And I said, what's wrong? And he said, well, he's like, I got a little problem.
I just said, what happened to you?
And I said, what? And he kind of looked up, and I saw his teeth, and they were all, I mean, all of a sudden his front teeth were just, like, messed up so bad.
He just said, man, you didn't hear? I was in New Orleans last week and was on, you know, went on the wrong street. Some guy cold cocked me. I said, oh, my gosh, man, you are messed up.
Well, all I could think about was, man, you're going to have some serious dental work done. I'm thinking, my gosh, your teeth are, I mean, they're ruined. And then all of a sudden, he's kind of, his eyes started twinkling a little bit, and then he started moving those false teeth up and down with his tongue.
And then he yanked them out, and I just said, I've got to get some of those. Those are the best teeth I've ever seen.
And I was like, you know, that is so bad. I mean, he had me hook, line, and sinker.
It's one of those deals when you get somebody that good, you lay up that night and just laugh for no reason, knowing you got that guy.
There's no question that Payne loved to party, loved to have fun, and loved his music.
Payne was not a very good musician with a group, okay? But on his own, playing the harmonica, he could go.
The important thing was how much he loved it. You know, was he a great harmonica player? No.
You know, kind of turned down his mic a little bit. We had to encourage him not to sing a whole lot, but his spirit was there.
Payne Stewart could sing off key as well as anybody. He had more than anything, he had energy and he had passion. He wasn't always blowing the right notes, but it was coming out loud and strong.
I told you this thing was awesome. The world's first 60-inch plasma HD TV from Zenith. An epic experience just 4 inches deep from the high-definition authority, Zenith.
They both worked hard. Took care of business. Took care of their families. So why will one leave his loved ones with every advantage while the other leaves everything to chance? Some people already know our financial representatives excel at a lot more than life insurance. Northwestern Mutual Financial Network. Are you there yet?
Chances are you've seen this card before, and you may know that over 1 million AAA Texas members carry it for the peace of mind that the nation's largest roadside assistance network can offer. You should too, because you never know when you or your family will run into one of life's little surprises. For towing, lockouts, flat tires, and just about any kind of assistance on the road, AAA Texas can help keep you moving when life wants to slow you down. We'll even refer you to an approved mechanic that you can trust to fix your car the right way. But that's just part of being a member. Call to join now, and you can also enjoy savings on auto insurance and all of those AAA vacation deals you hear about. And you can even get savings of up to 30% on everything from hotels and entertainment to new eyeglasses and more. So join now for $49 and get the card that can pay for itself. With such big benefits, it can help you handle life's little inconveniences and give you and your family a lot more peace of mind. Call 1-800-417-1475 to join today and get a free membership for someone in your family of $44 value.
After the U.S. Open in 91, I tried to improve my golf game to get better. Hell, I was already there and didn't realize it. You know, I was already there. I was at the top. I was doing everything right, and I went and I changed something to get better.
When he won the Open, he said, all right, now I have to be more serious because I'm the U.S. Open champion and I'm going to act accordingly. And I remember he just decided that he was going to be different. Well, it was the worst thing that could have happened to Payne.
So he was, you know, he was kind of a lost person. You know, he couldn't, he wasn't performing at a level he knew he could perform at, and which kind of filtered down into his everyday life. I mean, he was basically miserable to be around.
He was busy. And some of the times we couldn't get it, you know, we'd call and see if we could go out dinner and a movie or something, and then, you know, he said, well, let me check my calendar. It's one of those things, and well, we got, looks like we got a day that we can do that in about 3 weeks.
His attitude was so bad. I mean, he was angry a lot, and he was surly and things like that. And I know that Tracy talked to him and said, look, you know, if you're really unhappy, I said, you just shouldn't be doing this. And at that time, I know he made a commitment to change his attitude.
As, you know, we get older, all of us tend to change in some way or another. And then I guess when I got sick, it had a big impact on Payne's life.
I think that was a big jolt to him to realize that Paul, you know, was so young and so healthy. All of a sudden, he had cancer and could die.
His dad's bone scan looked like mine did, and he freaked out when he saw it.
You know, to know that he lost his father that way and realizing just how deadly and dangerous cancer can be. So I think it had a big impact on Payne. And in a roundabout way, it kind of opened his eyes a little bit more to realize, hey, we're all vulnerable to anything at any given time. So certainly be thankful for what you have.
And he saw the strength that Paul had in his faith. And I think that really impressed Payne a lot.
You can encourage a guy or whatever about any aspect of life, but when it comes to belief in a living, risen God, you know, I mean, only God can change hearts, you know, and but of course you have to make that decision at some point. And I think that Payne took that upon himself, made that decision, there's no question about it.
I think that prompted Payne to ask me about the First Academy and what it was all about. You know, I just told Payne how great a school it was and how much emphasis they put on Christianity with the kids. And you know, they brought a lot of things home from school with them and touched Payne's heart with it.
We would have to, you know, help them with their Bible study and everything. And I think that Payne just started to really, you know, look and read more into it. And so Oral Hershiser is a friend, and he was having a Bible study at the church and had invited Payne to come along as well. And he just seemed to grow deeper and deeper into his faith.
As friends of his, you do see him in the down times. You do see him when he's not the life of the party. And so you want to help people like that. And he starts asking questions. You start maybe having a few answers for what's worked in your life. And then there becomes just an ongoing conversation.
And that was really kind of the first time that I really talked to Payne about anything spiritual is when I noticed him wearing the bracelet. You know, Aaron had, you know, given it to him, and what would Jesus do? You know, it was something that he was trying to apply to his life. He did have a sincere and genuine faith in God and in Jesus Christ, and so therefore he wore this bracelet, and it meant something to him.
My family has made me put a perspective on my life that golf is something that I do, but my family is most important thing.
He just really was so happy to have children. You know, if it was up to him, we would have had probably six of them.
He gave the most important thing you can give to your kids and your family. He gave love, unconditional love to his family.
My daughter, she's in seventh grade and playing on the eighth grade volleyball team at First Academy here in Orlando. And she's going to be a teenager in November, which will be a new experience for a mother and I.
He used to call me Silly Goose because I used to do really dumb stuff.
She was his little girl.
Chelsea was Payne's prince.
Athlete. There's every reason to be proud, but he was just proud because that was his daughter.
You know, they just had such a special relationship.
Payne would go to Chelsea's volleyball games and would just yell and critique every point.
He almost got kicked out of one of my games. He was so loud.
Payne was so embarrassing. He was in the middle. He was screaming, "Go Chelsea, go Chelsea!"
Very loud, very loud.
The coaches found a way to silence Payne. And the way they did that was they made Payne the line judge.
Line judges can't say anything, so I was just cracking up because he couldn't talk or anything.
So all he could say was in or out. And that was the way the coaches muffled Payne.
And my son is, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree.
That's not good.
Oh, you know, it's going to be scary as he gets older. He's 9 years old and just full of a lot of energy.
Who do people tell you you look like?
My dad.
He looks like Payne.
If there's a person on earth that's Payne Stewart, it's Aaron Stewart.
He walks like Payne.
The same smile.
He acts like Payne.
Just like his dad.
In his eyes.
If you want to see the spitting image of Payne, you just have to go and meet Aaron.
Is that a good thing?
Hopefully.
He played football. His first year he got to play football, and Payne was a great spectator. I mean, the referees wanted to throw him out every time that he showed up, you know. Aaron would always be challenged, like Payne would throw him the keys or something and he'd drop them, you know, he'd say brick, you know, and he'd just give him a hard time, brick.
He teased me, he called me brick hands, so every time I dropped the ball, he would say that I've got brick hands.
He'd just say brick, 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 you know, and Aaron hated that.
And when I would score a touchdown, he would stand up on the bleachers and say, "Way to go, Bricks."
It was the last game of the season, and they were asked to pick names for themselves. And Aaron had picked the name Brick. So they introduced him as Aaron the Brick Stewart.
He also, you know, he was a disciplinarian. He wanted the kids to have values and to do the right thing.
I got to set an example for my kids. I don't want them to act the way I used to act. And hopefully they'll learn from that, and they'll, sometime in their life, they'll say, "You know, Dad used to tell me that, not to do that, or Dad used to tell me to do this, or he was right." You know, they'll look, he was right. You know, they'll be growing their family up, and, "Well, that's what Dad used to tell me." That'd mean I'm getting my point across, and I think that's why I am more mature now.
For the holidays, brought to you by the United States Postal Service, your holiday shipping center.
Starts with good listening. That's what really impressed me on my first meeting with my prudential advisors. They asked a lot of questions, they listened, they took a lot of notes, and after a couple of hours had enough information to go away and formulate a plan for me and my investments. So that when I came back in, I know I had been heard, and the advice that I was getting was really grounded in some very good financial thinking.
Winter Wonderland, brought to you by the United States Postal Service, your holiday shipping center.
Some of the biggest names in entertainment, Dan Marino, Jim Courier, and John Elway, pair up with some of the biggest names in golf, Fred Couples, Scott McCarron, and Rich Beam. Join them and many more for the Kiowa Pro Celebrity Challenge, Saturday at 8 p.m. on the Golf Channel.
Hi, everybody. Mike Ritz here, coming up on the next edition of Golf Central. Highlights from the PGA of America's Grand Slam. Wait till you see what Tiger did this time in Hawaii. That and much more, 10:30 Eastern.
would just get so excited to play in the U.S. Open each year.
The reason why Payne was always great at the U.S. Open is because Payne Stewart had a great gift for creativity.
It takes real soft hands to hit shots around the greens in the U.S. Open.
I think if we had 42 majors throughout the year, Payne would have won a lot more tournaments.
To win the U.S. Open was the ultimate in golf, in my husband's opinion.
His father had such an appreciation for the U.S. Open and held it in such high esteem.
When he was signing up his applications, he had him sign his full name, William Payne Stewart.
Payne was, he was fired up.
I watched the third round from start to finish on TV, and I just said that you're moving your head, you know, on your putting, you need to keep your head down. And he agreed and said, okay, we'll go work on it.
It was good because he needed something, you know, that he could focus on. It was perfect, just, you know, I couldn't ask for anything more.
Payne played really solid those first three rounds. He had a one-shot lead over Phil Mickelson going into the last round. I drove him over there and dropped him off, and I said, you know, just believe in yourself, trust your swing, and I said, believe in your heart that you can do it. And he looked at me and he said, I got a big heart. You know, that was kind of a joke between us about his enlarged heart. And I said, I know you do, lovey. You can do it. Kiss goodbye, and off he went.
And from Orlando, Florida, Payne Stewart.
It's almost like match play between Payne and Phil. Actually, by the time they got to 16, Phil had taken the lead. He was sitting at minus one, Payne was even, and they had some pretty tough par putts.
And then he was faced with a putt that was breaking two ways. It was uphill, then downhill. And I was just hoping that he would two putt.
It's like one of those putts that's got a little bit of everything in it, you know?
3,000 to 1, he was going to miss that putt.
I thought, if anything, he was going to have to guard against three putting.
Ooh, that's a double brass, tough.
I just jumped and screamed and said, come on, you can do it on the next hole.
He was chomping that gum like he chews, and he had that focus in his eyes.
I've never seen him as focused as he was, ever.
No, it's not going to move that much. He yanked it.
Now the crowd's into it. Payne's completely focused, and we're all even going to 17. When we approached the 17th green, the crowd was in a complete frenzy. I mean, they were screaming and hollering and yelling.
Over it again. One hole to play. Stewart leads by one.
And he hit it down the right side, just over the trap here, as we got to the crest of the hill. We couldn't see Payne's ball.
How bad is that lie, Roger?
It is no good at all.
It was the worst lie it had all week. He hit a good shot, laid it up just short of the trap.
He said, oh no,
it's all going right of the hole, John.
Well, it looks like pretty much a par by Mickelson, and it's gonna have to be a heroic up and in for Payne Stewart, otherwise there will be a playoff.
And I said, where's Payne? And he said, he's out there in the fairway, hitting his third shot. And I went, oh no, here we go again.
Chance to win it.
The walk-up 18 was just a very special moment. The ovation both golfers got that day was just very special. you know, with the bells, as you can probably hear in the background now, they were playing that day. And the combination of the bells and it being Father's Day made it just a very, very unique moment. You know, he was right in this area here, about 20 feet short of the hole, and Phil was a little further away. He was 35 feet away.
Looking at his putt, I knew that if I were to miss and give him a free roll at the wind, that there was it was very likely that that ball was going to go in.
Borrowed too much. Now Stewart, one putt to win.
We screamed and hollered and jumped up and down. And
I was running around, high-fiving inanimate objects.
I was speechless.
You beauty, he kept saying. Yeah, you could see him when he grabs my face. You beauty, you beauty.
Came over to me and talked about what a wonderful experience I'm going to be having here shortly, becoming a father.
And I sang out to him as loud as I could, even though he was just a foot or two away. And he turned around and hugged me, and he said, I kept my head down, I kept my head down. I said, I know you did, I'm so proud of you.
What a finish.
Start at $19.99 a month.
My new baby's name is Max. He's waking up about now. My business partner's name is Joe.
This has everything you're looking for.
I see him more than I see Max. It's also my birthday. And I wouldn't mind working from home today.
I'ma be your ride. I'll keep on dancing.
Better way.
What a day for a daydream. What a day for a daydreaming boy. And I'm lost in a daydream.
Whoa, Grandma. Where's Grandpa?
On the boat.
One tournament nobody wants to play in. PGA Tour Q School. Because it's golf's version of hell. Six frustrating rounds, 108 of the most nerve-wracking holes in golf. And it's not whether you win or lose, it's whether you survive. Because the top 35 get PGA Tour cards, their ticket to the big show. The PGA Tour Qualifying Tournament. It has more drama than TNT, and it's only on the Golf Channel.
Payne loved the Ryder Cup. I mean, you know, he lived for the Ryder Cup.
When they raised that flag and played the national anthem, he got way up for it.
I'm patriotic. That's just, you know, I'm proud to be an American.
And I was with him for a large number of major championships over the years. And the Ryder Cup was the one that he got the most up for and got the most excited about and got the most tense for.
Payne's first Ryder Cup was in 1987, and it was not fun.
That was my first.
Absolutely eat him up inside. Oh. Not only lose as captain, but lose at his golf course.
First time ever in the United States at his golf course, him being captain. It was not fun. He didn't sugarcoat anything. He just got right in your face and said, you guys don't know how to win.
If we hadn't played the 18th hole, we'd have won the matches easily. Our guys just weren't finishing. They weren't just going after it. And I think I had you know, try to kick him in the rear end a little bit, you might say. And I suppose, I guess Payne was one of them I probably kicked.
And he got right in my face and says, how come you don't win more? You know, you win all this money, why don't you win tournaments? And it's kind of like, here I am, a little rookie on in the Ryder Cup, and I'm just being, but that's the way Jack is. Jack's not used to losing, you know, and he doesn't accept losing. And so that probably made me a better player.
Payne's seen it all in the Ryder Cup. You know, wins, losses, ties.
Pulls off a remarkable recovery. Payne Stewart's putt has stopped the European rally.
What a shot. This might go. Right in the heart. What a comeback.
Understandably, the American jubilation is complete.
One thing he always brought was his music.
Man, when that alarm clock went off, that music was playing so loud.
Queen, you know, we are the champions of the world. And it was cranking down the hallways. I mean, cranking.
Full blast, I'm telling you. And Hero started complaining about it because it was so loud. But, you know, we're loving it. We're eating it up.
And I was like, Payne, we haven't won yet. I know, but we can, and we will.
But that's always been one of my goals, is to be on the Ryder Cup team. And I haven't been on the last two teams, and they've lost. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
And he said, I really want to be on this team.
You got to have people that know how to motivate people and to keep free people from getting down, from playing bad or getting beat or whatever. And I'm that person. I'm a motivator.
Of course, being captain, I very much enjoyed his comments, and hoping that that would that idea would spread, and it did.
It's a record day, record gallery. This putt looks pretty good, right in the middle of the hole. What a golf shot.
My goodness.
Wow. What a match this could turn out to be.
Man, that was huge.
Wow. 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 Looks pretty good. Wow. Another point for the United States. What a comeback. Well, the little boys come out now. There it is, and Ben Crenshaw knows it. United States has won the Ryder Cup.
He defended Monty that whole day out there. I mean, Monty took some incredible abuse.
The crowd's been, was really tough on Colin all day, and we'd won the cup, and that's why I came to win the cup. It's not about my personal, whether I beat him or not. He didn't deserve to have to hit that putt, and so I gave it to him. The cup was over. It didn't matter.
And by him conceding that putt, he proved to the whole world that his own personal achievement did not mean anything to him. It was the fact that we had won the Ryder Cup.
It just goes to show you how far he had come as a person and how thoughtful he was.
Hey, it's been a special year, and to win the way that we won today, this completes my year.
Microsoft Server Software. You can quickly connect with partners. That's software for the agile business from Microsoft.
Pike's Peak. Where the wind breaks the speed limit. The snowfall breaks the records. And a single company breaks from the status quo. Audi, the only luxury car company with quattro all-wheel drive in every model line.
I'm singing in the rain, just singing in the rain. I'm happy again.
Want over 200 channels with crystal clear reception even when it rains? You can't get that from satellite.
I'm singing and dancing in
Time Warner Cable. Now, anything's possible.
You've probably heard some of the recent stories about LASIK. Now it's time to make a decision about your vision based on sound facts. Dr. Andrew Watkins and the Heights Eye Center offer the very latest in laser technology and years of experience in performing the LASIK procedure. Don't your eyes deserve the very best care possible? Get the facts about LASIK. Call the Heights Eye Center at 713-862-6631. That's 713-862-6631.
Payne had bought my mother a watch several years ago, and my parents were staying with us during the accident. Mum and Dad had gone out to the Epcot Center, and that morning at 9:30, my mother, her watch stopped, and 9:30 was right when they would have all perished.
Her pain, I don't think I will ever see anyone in so much anguish.
The minister came over from her church, and you know, people started to come over, which was great, and I think they weren't sure whether they should go over or not, but it was really good that they came over, and it helped.
But it was so chaotic, so horrible, so painful.
The funeral was unbelievable. I've never felt so much camaraderie as I did that day. And so many hugs, you know, a tear in their eye. I mean, we all had that same heartsick feeling, all of us.
We're gonna laugh and we're gonna cry a little bit, probably, and that's okay.
On Wednesday morning, I spoke to my good friend Vince Gill, and Vince and I just reminisced about Payne. And he mentioned to me that the night before he had written a song for our buddy.
So we found a way to get into the studio Thursday and make this recording, and they were kind enough to include it in the service.
Hey God, I just lost a dear old friend.
The speeches and the talk at the memorial service and was uplifting, funny at times, everybody crying at times. And it basically just showed the amount of care and warmth that is amongst all the PGA Tour players. It's one big family out there.
1992, Payne had to return the U.S. Open trophy that he'd won in 1991 and had to go to Pebble Beach for a media day. We were sitting in the lounge at the lodge at Pebble Beach, and this boisterous guy came up to us and said, "That guy said you're Payne Stewart. I don't believe it." Payne said, "Well, if I go get the U.S. Open trophy," he says, "will you keep filling it up with whatever I want to drink? Will that prove it to you?" And the guy says, "You bet I will." So Payne went over and brought the U.S. Open trophy over and turned to the bartender. He says, "Bring us some bottles of Cristal champagne." And Cristal champagne is very expensive, but at the lodge at Pebble Beach, it is really expensive, I want to tell you.
You had six people that all had the same faith. Bruce Borland was actively involved in the church. Two pilots were, Robert and Van. And Payne was a new believer. It's almost as if God said to these six, "You have fought the good fight. You have finished the race. And now I'm going to take you home, and I'm going to impact the world."
I'll never forget the mistake he made when he told me the story of the time that he started his bass boat in his garage. He said he was so happy that it kicked on. He was very surprised, but he kept revving in the engine. Oh, oh, oh. An outboard engine cannot run without water. And it exploded. And then he made the mistake of telling me.
Yeah, I don't know how you could speak at your spouse's, you know, memorial service. To get up and do that is almost superhuman.
Finally, I thank God for Payne. We shed laughter, tears, victories, and defeats. You will always be my soulmate and my best friend. As I look back now, I realize that even after 18 years of marriage, Payne was still the most beautiful man I'd ever seen. not because of the way he looked on the outside anymore, but because of what was on the inside. We love you. Let the party in heaven begin. Thank you.
There is a depth there with her. That's one strong lady and some strong kids. And the bond that she and Payne had, and the seeds that Payne planted in the kids when he was with them, they're going to blossom.
In a very ironic way, Payne's death has brought many people closer together with their loved ones, made them re-examine their relationships, re-examine their own lives. I know it has with me.
We miss him. The kids are going to miss him tremendously. Tracy's going to miss him. He made a huge impact on a lot of people's lives, and all of us just have to have enough faith to say, God's got a bigger plan.
The fog was almost like you're in heaven. You know, I guess the thing that still gives me goosebumps is hearing the bagpiper.
I actually considered not playing, but I can just hear, you know, Payne saying, you know, boys, you gotta play in the Southern Twine. You know, Payne was a guy who was a very emotional guy. He loved to laugh, and he wasn't ashamed to cry. And so I know I'm not gonna be ashamed of my tears this morning. Neither should you. You know, six people got on that airplane on Monday. And today, there's wives without husbands, there's kids without fathers. There's a golf world that's missing a hero. There's a tour that's missing a great champion. There's a bunch of people missing a great friend. All of us were a part of Payne, and Payne is definitely a part of us. And when he died on Monday, a big part of us died too.
When the bagpiper walked away, all this dew on the ground, and the fog was just starting to lift, and all you could see were this set of footprints that went down the fairway. Payne Stewart's footsteps, you know, he walked away into heaven. You know, he's not here anymore.
They both worked their way up the ladder. Same executive perks, same six-figure salaries. So why does one look forward to early retirement, while the other looks forward to the 15th and the 31st? Some people already know our financial representatives excel at a lot more than life insurance. Northwestern Mutual Financial Network. Are you there yet?
What happened?
You just put your car in the river.
Do you really love golf? Then you'll love Golfsmith. All the top brands and the latest technology. If it's golf, it's Golfsmith.
I told you this thing was awesome.
The 60-inch plasma HD TV, 4 inches deep, from Zenith.
On a special Peter Jacobson Plugged In, it's the inaugural All Jake Team Selection Show. Don't miss the fun as Peter and his gang bring you the most unusual highlights, lowlights, and most off-the-wall moments of the year in golf. Peter Jacobson Plugged In, the All Jake Team Special on the Golf Channel.
An impressive list of competitors will meet, including John Daly, Peter O'Malley, and Greg Norman of the Australian PGA Championship. Tonight at 11 p.m. Eastern.
Hi, everybody. Mike Ritz here. Coming up on the next edition of Golf Central, highlights from the PGA of America's Grand Slam. Wait till you see what Tiger did this time in Hawaii. That and much more, 10:30 Eastern.
When Payne passed away, I lost a best friend. I lost a brother.
A part of my life that was fun.
I lost my innocence.
He was all about life. He was about living.
It's like a giant empty hole in Springfield.
There'll never be another Payne Stewart.
It's hard to tell how great the day has been until the sun sets. I don't think any of us thought the sun was setting for Payne Stewart, but it's given, I think, all of us a chance to look back and say how great the day has been.
He's here with us. I mean, I feel him all the time, and I think he'll be with us until we get to heaven, and he's there to greet us. Tracy were just so much in love, and to watch them together, you could feel, even just the way they look at each other, the way he would hold her face, the way he would kiss her. They just loved each other with a love that you don't really find nowadays. To see those two together, the love that they had for one another and their family. Payne would rather be with them than anybody.
Tell me a little bit about the necklace that you're wearing.
It was my dad's. I don't know what it means, but I just wear it because it was my dad's.
I just lost a dear old friend. Hey God, hope he's in your angel band. Hey God, you know he believed in. Why you do the things you do. Hey God, send me down some comfort, please. Hey God, I'll be down here on my knees. Will we ever comprehend the forgiveness and grace that lies waiting in the end? Well, there's anger and tears for all of the years that your children won't have you to hold. Though my heart has been broken, angels have spoken, still I wish I could have watched you grow old. Hey God, I know we didn't die alone. Hey God, tell my old friend welcome home. Hey God, please hear me when I pray. Pray for a little peace till we meet again someday. little piece till we meet again someday.
Channel. Get updates on